Hello and welcome to the fourth module of this course on labor and decent work in supply chains. Now, previously in this course, we learned that labor law, on the one hand, sought to reduce unfairness in relationships between employers and employees, and on the other, sought to establish some minimum standards for work. We learned about several Indian statutes that pursued these two different objectives. They gave rights to employees and placed duties and obligations upon employers.
To take a simple example, the minimum wages law gave workers the right to be paid the declared minimum wage and placed a duty on employers to pay that amount. But what happens when an employee is not paid this wage for the work done? For a worker's right to a minimum wage to be meaningful, the person holding that right must be able to access it when it has been denied. The systems through which these rights can be accessed are known as remedies. The remedy for a worker who has not been paid the declared minimum wage is an order from a court or an administrative authority that can compel the employer to pay the minimum wage. Many such remedies are found in the Industrial Disputes Act of 1947. As we learned previously, this law provides the framework for fairly resolving disputes related to employment or non-employment, or the terms of employment, or the conditions of labor.
Under this Industrial Dispute Act, there is a whole concept called the arbitration mechanism or industrial grievances mechanism. And these grievance mechanism basically functions as a proper legal functions, particularly to provide the legal remedies. And these industrial dispute system, industrial arbitration reconciliation system, is basically gives the equal rights to the workers and then equal rights to the employer establishment. So there's nobody who are kind of the one will be on the lower side or one will be on the upper side. Everybody will be equal, and the whole concept what we call as a tripartite mechanism. So whenever any dispute arise, talk about wages, talk about social security, talk about occupational health, talk about occupational working condition. So in all these conditions, there is a proper grievance mechanism which have a capacity, which have a basically a proper methodology to resolve the problem. And through the tripartite principle, where the state will facilitate and the employer and the employee both together along with the state can resolve the dispute by having the collective bargaining or by having the kind of the equal kind of negotiation on those tables. So yeah, there's a kind of summary to give you the perspective basically that how our labor law is so progressive. If you can make a case that the workers are part of any particular establishment, and there's a very clear identification that who's employee and who's employer. As I said, the Industrial Dispute Act and Industrial Standing Order Act, these are two very important laws as far as the grievance redressal is concerned. So there are number of mechanism which is very much embedded in these laws, which I said just now, Dispute Act and Standing Order Act. And these mechanisms have a grievance redressal mechanism where any dispute arises, the workers can go, and even the employers, even the what we call the Malik, they can also go and approach that dispute mechanism. And that dispute mechanism will be facilitated by the state, like let's say that labor commissioner or additional labor officer who will facilitate this dialogue and bring all these two important stakeholders, employees and employer, bring on the table and can sort of do the dispute resolution through the tripartite dialogue process. So labor code is a body where, as I said, that any stakeholders part of the labor market mechanism can approach them, and the labor code has a power to basically do the dispute resolution. It depends what is your concern. If you're concerned with regard to minimum wages, you can go file the cases in the labor court, and labor court can issue a kind of challan or issue a kind of take a cognizance and can ask the employer to pay the 10 times of wages if there is any cases of wages abuse. What I would call the labor abuse in terms of non-payment of wages or the wages withheld or the non-payment of minimum wages, like these kind of concerns. Same thing is about the entire question of the worker safety. So labor court is essentially means that if you want to sort of initiate any civil proceedings or any kind of the criminal proceedings, right? There the labor code is very, 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 very effective in terms of resolving the area. But I would like to say one thing very important, that in India, wages are considered as a property, as an asset under the Companies Act. And in 1982, Supreme Court, in a historical judgment, the case called Bandhwa Mukti Morcha versus Union of India, the Supreme Court said that if you are not paying someone's minimum wages, is basically subject to the violation of Article 23 of the Constitution of India, which says that if you compel someone against their will or force someone to work, it is equal to the violation of fundamental rights of the Constitution. That means you are pushing someone for the slavery, you are pushing someone to do the forced labor, and therefore it is subject for the criminal cognizance, right? So labor court also have a power to basically take such cognizance of the labor related matter as a criminal proceeding, as a criminal of offenses, and therefore all these resolutions can be solved through the labor court mechanism. The labor is in concurrent list. So large number of labor dispute questions or dispute concerns are resolved through the state authority. A state has a power to basically create a number of courts. It can be on the district level. It can be also on tehsil level. In some of the states, there are labor courts who are also on the tehsil level. There are some labor courts who are also on the district level. So it depends which state you are in. For example, I am presently based in Maharashtra, so there is a labor court in each and every district. If you go to Andhra Pradesh, if you go to Tamil Nadu, you may also find the labor court on the tehsil level. So it depends which state you are in right now. Yeah. So governance is basically a kind of very diverse. It depends on state to state, but mostly, largely, it exists on the district level. A large number of, I mean, there's so many concerns. So to name a few, wages concerned, the wages withheld, payment of wages, minimum wages. If there is any question of the layoff, so there is a lot of layoffs because a lot of large number of contract workers, when they talk about the union power, when they talk about the collective bargaining for a lot of their issues. So they basically, the company, the establishment lay off large number of workers. So if there is any layoff, workers can go and approach the labor tribunal, labor court. Same goes with the retrenchment. So large number of cases of retrenchment also come to the labor court and also goes to the higher authority. Also the cases of the working conditions. If you go and work somewhere when there is not a very good working condition, especially for the women workers, when there is a no crutches facility, when there is a no welfare officer at the company or at the factory level, they can go and approach to the labor court. So all these cases can belong to the number of areas: wages, occupational safety, working condition, layoff, retrenchment, the contracts. So there's a big, very, the very, very big list of the concerns. Yes. These are social security measures, and these can be also addressed to the concern authority. But for these concerns, there are some kind of dedicated officer. For example, EPFO, there is an EPFO commissioner, which is Employment Provident Fund, Employment Provident Fund organization. Same with the ESIC, Employees State Insurance Corporation. Same goes with the gratuity, same goes with the bonus. So for all these, beautiful laws, very, very beautiful laws, very, very strong laws, which give the statutory guarantee to the workers as far as social security is concerned. So for that, Ministry of Labour and Employment has created a number of organizations, and whether it is a dedicated commissioner who can also look into the matter. But you can also, if the government authority like an EPFO commission doesn't resolve your crisis, doesn't resolve your problem, you can actually approach to labor court or the industrial tribunal. You can also go to the high court and Supreme Court for that. Yeah, there is a check and balance. There is a layers of authority where if you do not get justice from the one layer, then you can go to the next layer, the next layer, the next layer, the number of layers. Yeah, there are, for example, for the ESIC, you have a ESIC commissioner, and there is also what we call on the central level, there is a basically the tripartite committee within the ESIC system. So a lot of issues you can resolve it by discussing all these, what we call the CBT, Central Board of Trustees, within the ESIC system. Same goes with the EPFO system. So if the CBT, you can go resolve, raise the issue that you don't have ESIC hospital in the X area, and therefore there has to be a proposal. So in the CBT, the employer, employee, all are members of the CBT, Central Board of Trustees, which basically Ministry of Labor is a central nodal ministry facilitated, and you come up with a proposal and you you discuss the issue. CBT is basically accountable to resolve this crisis. If CBT doesn't resolve it, you have the power to go and make an appeal in the High Court or the Supreme Court also. Yeah.
As you can see, India's labor statutes have created an extensive judicial and administrative mechanism for the negotiation of disputes relating to work. These mechanisms are the systems through which several workers access their rights under these statutes. These include their rights in relation to wages, their conditions of work, and to social security.
We also learned, however, that most Indian labor statutes apply only to limited types of work. Most of them are limited either to some types of establishments or to some types of workers.
Let me quickly talk about that how these labor laws are kind of relevant as far as the today's economy is concerned. So let me begin by saying that large number of labor laws in India deals with the organized sector, because majority of the labor laws, like Industrial Dispute Act or what I would call Mines Act, or Trade Union Act, what I would call the Minimum Wages Act, Industrial Standing Order Act. So all these labor laws, like kind of very, very super, radical, super effective labor laws, essentially meant for organized sector. However, if you see the labor market characteristics have changed in the last two decades, three decades, especially when the neoliberal economies were introduced in the late early 90s, 1991, when the Manmohan Singh, then the finance minister, introduced the new liberal economic policy. They talked about the flexible labor market, they talked about more benefits to the industry so that they will create a lot of jobs. But actually, they went against of the core labor rights framework, the core labor rights, kind of statutory kind of principles. So there is a basically the theory which says that large number of labor laws do not address the current labor market problem, do not address the present labor market characteristics. To illustrate this example, you see that India's economy are largely exist in the realm of informal economy, and there's a government data itself say that 93% of the working population falls under the informal sector, or what we call largely the unorganized sector. And when you read these labor laws, it has a lot of criteria where such archaic labor laws may not be applicable in current situation. For example, the ESIC Act, the Employees State Insurance Corporation Act, it talks about the establishment. It talks about until there is a 10 employees in any establishment, this law is not applicable, right? Same goes with the Factories Act. Factories Act also says that there has to be an establishment and there has to be 20 employees, and then only the Factory Act can be applicable. So you see this criteria, you see this framework where large number of workers in today's scenario may not able to get protection under these labor laws. I can go on, keep going on so many examples, like construction workers, like bricklaying workers, like street vendors, like waste pickers, like domestic workers. So you see these workers, they do not have any whole idea and whole concept of establishment. These workers do not have any idea what we call the employer-employee relationship. And therefore, there's a whole problem that all these labor laws talks about the clear principles of employee, employer, establishment, such kind of criteria that establishment should have like 10 workers, 20 workers, so on. So if you see all these criteria and see the current labor market, it is almost next to impossible to basically bring them or kind of resolve the problem of the informal sector workers in today's situation.
As we have learned from the history of the trade union movement, collective bargaining is another method that workers can use to negotiate better wages and conditions of work. But just like remedies under statute, however, this is also not universally available.
The Industrial Disputes Act applies to not only the manufacturing sector, it also applies to the service sector to the extent the employees in these sectors are could be covered under the workers definition. So there is a study by Dr. Jasim Pais, who concluded after doing an analysis of NSSO data that Industrial Dispute Act effectively covers about less than 10% of the total workforce in India, and if you exclude agriculture, it may slightly increase to maybe 15% or so, but not more than that. So agriculture is completely excluded. Plantations, manufacturing sector, public utilities like electricity sector, unless the essential service maintenance ordinance is imposed on these services. And of course, the service sector, because the right to form trade unions, excepting the government employee sector, is extended all over, save of course army and army related services. There has been a dispute whether police could form trade unions, but there are controversial views about it. 1979 in Tamil Nadu, the police started forming trade unions. But coming back to this point, that I should say that the right to form trade unions will cover, let us say, if we take 465 million as the total workforce, I should imagine that the right to form trade unions, including the self-employed, excluding the government sector, will be available to 80% of the total workers. But the right to conduct collective bargaining and the right to strike will not be available to the vast majority of workers, because the labor laws do not facilitate.
Only a limited set of workers in India have the right to strike, and that too in a limited set of circumstances. We will learn about this problem in greater detail later in this module. When we learnt about the supply chains for garments and sugar in India, we understood that large parts of these supply chains were not covered by India's labour laws. This meant, therefore, that workers working in some parts of these supply chains, primarily agriculture, could not access the rights given to them under Indian labour laws.
That a large number of these laws, these beautiful laws, cannot address the problem of the informal sector because of lot of exclusionary criteria. Because I understand it's an obvious problem. When these laws were enacted like 50 years ago, 60 years ago, that time there was no concept of the informal economy or the informal sector largely. We had an agrarian economy but as far as the informal sector in large is concerned, that was not the case when these laws were enacted. And therefore we are now fighting and struggling to bring this large number of workforce under the informal sector to this whole statutory framework or meant for the organized sector. As I said, ESIC, EPFO, bonus, gratuity, you know, also with the Industrial Dispute Act grievance mechanism. So that is our struggle. That is our ongoing struggle to bring this workforce under the purview of these beautiful laws, so that their issues can be also resolved. But the whole problem is that we have not been able to sort of build a case of employer. We got some success in the case of domestic workers. We have been managed to basically build the policy debate that who's employing and who is employer. But in the large number of cases, still the struggle is going on. And therefore, we are saying that the state should become, or state should behave as far as the role of the principal employer is concerned. And therefore, state should extend all the services, social security, occupational health and safety, etc., to all this workforce being a principal employer.
Because a vast majority of India's workers are not protected by India's labor laws, labor organizers and activists have sought out remedies from other parts of the state machinery.
There are very little remedy available for the sugarcane farm workers, but there are some available. For the women, there are some commissions, state women commission. If they complain, they may write and they should it. For the children, there are the SAPCR, State Commission for Protection of Child Rights, which is available. And some members, if they somebody complain, the members may go and also the, file the case against them. Some labor department also available in the village, district level. If someone complained to the labor department, the labor inspector can go and also do the inspection there, particularly on the issue of the equal wages and minimum wages. And these are the available, but hardly the people are using this mechanism for the remedies. And there are some system at the village level also. If Gram Pradhan, village head of the village panchayat head, are good of the nature, that Pradhan may also intervene. If somebody complains to the Pradhan, he will do something. So these are the depend upon the particular persons. But at the systematic, only the some commissions, some legal service authorities also available at the district level, some state commission of the children, women commission, also the labor department, which are the remedies they may provide some literacy.
Yeah, particularly my own experience, we taken some of the cases, Tamil Nadu Women Commission, who are not receiving PF, some problem, even death case, accident case, we taken to Tamil Nadu Women Commission, which is already reported to concerned department, but they not yet get their compensation. That kind of bending cases, it is not first cases, the bending cases, because we want to go first our district level authority. So if they will neglect, if they will take time, then only we want to take forward to state level official. So we cannot go directly state level official, because if we go directly state level official, they will forward again to district level official only. So therefore we went to district level officials, but they are not taken proper action. So that time we requested with the Women Commission, after 6 months, she organized a state level public hearing with the panelist, current judge, labor secretary, all the people they came. So that time we produced these cases, they inquiry these cases, they also already send it to before inquiry, someone to concerned department, labor department, textile suppliers, even though industrial safety and health director and also joint director, they also attended that public hearing. They taken forward, most of the worker, they received their compensation. That is, we have the experience. Also, we had training on consultation for this 7 district line department people, the government district level line department for labor department and also this industrial safety and health department, DCPU, district child protection unit department, also DSW, district social welfare officers. These all people, they involving in that, they have the responsibility for monitoring this textile supply chain, particularly workers. We invited them, we had the seminar for them at Tirupur with the collaboration with the Women Commission. So we taken all the labor law for the training. Also we questioned them what is their responsibility for take forward in any case, any cases if they will address, what is their responsibility, like that we taken.
Women workers are not getting the equal wages. So we should also, we are planning to raise this issue with the support of other concerned commissions and department to raise this voice collectively. The third aspect we are very much concerned about, that during the harvesting time, the schools are also the vacated by the children. So the family members ask the children to go to the sugar farm and do work with them. So our motive to also involve the labor department and also the child commission and also the education department to come together, during the harvesting time and sowing time, children should not involve in the farm sector of the sugarcane area. They should go to the school, they should also read in the schools, their presence should be ensured in the schools. So these are the, and the fourth aspect we are very much concerned, that we are planning to unionize them. To we form a collective in the different villages, particularly 3 districts we have formed in the village level of the farms collective. Women farmers are leading this collective. So we are planning to expand this collective to the different part of the state, so that they can raise their collective voice before the authority, and also they can raise their voice before the employer. and we also motivate them to form a union, so they may unionize them, and if they form the union, they can also follow up their cases before the authority, before the labor court, before the court. So these are some major area of our work.
In this video, we learnt about some of the remedies that are available under Indian labor law for workers to access their rights. Using these remedies, some Indian workers can access their rights to wages, working conditions, and social security. But a large section of Indian workers, we learnt, do not have access to these remedies.
As a result, labor leaders have looked to other parts of the state machinery, such as women's rights commissions, child rights commissions, and human rights commissions. The workers, even as they pursue these remedies, benefit from being organized. Partly because, when it comes to global supply chains, there are limits to the remedies that the state can provide by itself.
This brings governments into a very difficult position. If you have a country, for example, like Ethiopia, with hundreds of million dollars of investments now in the garment sector, and the government who wants to attract investors, they know exactly that investors will only come if the wages stay low. At the same time, the government is discussing a minimum wage. There is presently no minimum wage in Ethiopia, and unions and NGOs and some people in the government, they want a minimum wage, which is a living wage. But there are others who say if you implement a living wage, you have invested so much into your industry parks to attract investors, they will not come and set up factories because Cambodia or other countries might be cheaper.
Countries compete among each other to become part of global supply chains. Corporate decisions over where to locate their operations foster competition among countries over wage and employment flexibility, and by avoiding trade unions. These are often countries that compete among each other to achieve economic development by exporting the same set of goods. Labor organizers and activists, therefore, have also had to pursue strategies that are global.
Since 2011, there are UN guiding principles on businesses and human rights, and we have a discussion in many countries to implement these guiding principles into national legislation. If we would have something like this, for example, here in Germany, but the industry is resisting that, the industry would have a due diligence for the labor conditions in the whole value chain, all down to the seeds for the cotton. And that would be a big progress, because then they couldn't hide anymore against behind too low minimum wages, for example, in a country, or non-existing minimum wages. Companies are, according to the United Nations, responsible for human rights due diligence in their value chain, and paying a wage where people can live from is part of a very basic human rights.
What can workers do to access decent work, especially when they are unable to access labor rights, or when there is a failure to enforce labor law in their country? That is what we will learn in the next video of this module. We will look at some recent innovations that workers have used to access labor rights and decent work that are independent of the administration and judiciary of their countries. Thank you for watching.